take advantage of being here, and I would certainly advise all of you. But he's been very kind in this, and I think he has the least number of equations, possibly no equations at all in his thesis, and that's also a good thing. So everyone should be able to stay understanding what he's doing right to the very end. Okay, well, thanks very much, T. I'll let you go.
Thank you, Walter, for a very kind introduction. My name is Umnouy or Ponsukcharoen, and for non-Thai speakers, my name will be the most difficult thing in this thesis presentation. Before diving into the impact of distributed PV generations on grid operation, I would like your help on two things. First, please keep the questions to the end of the session. And second, whether you want to share me or you feel pity for my poor presentation, just keep smiling. Thank you. Now I can relax a little bit and
deep breath. Thank
you. Okay, let me start with a story. In the Rio Olympic Games, there was a weightlifter who made a headline. He did not win the competition. He danced after lifting the weight. In this picture, you can see he looks happy, but there is a sad truth behind it. He danced because he wants the world to aware that his home country, Kiribati, is about to vanish because of the sea level rise. Mm-hmm. And the sea level rise comes from global warming. But some of you may wonder if you are in land, why do we care about global warming? Actually, it's a big deal for everyone. As the mean temperature of atmosphere increase, the fluctuation of temperature increase as well. That leads to a higher number of unexpected and giant storms. A storm like Katrina caused about $1 billion property damage, not to account human life. There are many efforts to mitigate the greenhouse gas emission, and one of them is to generate electricity without burning fossil fuels. But how can we do that? Photovoltaic or PV technology is a choice of clean and renewable energy. It's like a poster child of renewables. Not only is it clean, it can generate electricity directly with only few components. A PV system comprised of a solar panel that captures sunlight into direct current electricity, and an inverter that converts direct current to alternate current, which is the form that we use nowadays. PV technology has been invented in the 70s, and the price has dropped significantly due to several factors: technologies, business innovation, and government support. One of the interesting questions is that, is energy from PV systems enough to fuel our civilization? The answer is yes, and we don't need much land to do so. This figure was presented by Elon Musk a few years earlier before he laid out the plans to colonize the Mars. And sorry for the picture, but this is supposed to be a US map. And a tiny dot here in Texas is the surface area enough to fuel demand in US. And that's the solution. Thank you everyone for coming. not that fast. There are many challenges that we need to face, and they come from both space and time. What do I mean by that? First, space. We need to deliver energy across space, because the electric power consumption or load is scattered everywhere. That's why we need electrical network or grid in order to deliver energy from generators like hydropower or coal power plants to consumers like us. If the generators are too far from consumers, the delivery will be costly or even impossible. Now, the good news is that we have a certain form of PV called distributed PV, and it's increasing. That kind of PV puts the solar panels on the residential or commercial places. Now that the generation is close to consumption, the burden in terms of space reduced. However, there is another heavy cost aspect called time. Imagine that you are a marathon organizer. One of the most important things you need to prepare is water. How would you make sure that you have enough water for everyone? Well, you need to come up with a prediction of how many people are coming to run and how much each person drinks. Then you need to schedule your water delivery with a supplier to get enough water. Then a few days earlier before the actual event, you may have some new information, say the weather forecast says it's going to be very hot on that day. Then you need to update your prediction and schedule another set of water from a supplier who responds faster. You also need to have some extra water as a backup as well. On the actual event, you have your subordinates sending water to everyone. That's pretty much the same to the energy delivery, except the fact that you need to organize this kind of marathon every 15 minutes or less, 24/7, and you cannot store energy easily like water. Mm-hmm. Now, the problem gets even worse when you have solar power into it, the picture. It's like making a deal with a nasty supplier. You are their delivery may not be in sync with what you need, and amount you get can be largely different from what you expect. Like I said, the solar power is like a poster child of renewables, but like all children, they can be mischievous. Now, you may say, what's the big deal here? You can miss a glass of cool and refreshing water in the marathon, or you can miss a show like Game of Thrones or Waves World, and you can watch it later. Actually, it is a big deal. When the grid, when the demand and supply in the grid is out of balance, it's damage the grid. It also damaged economy. According to Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, even typical power outage can cost about $80 billion per year, not to mention human life at risk because of this imbalance. You can see in this picture, it's quite strange to see the traffic light without a light. But this actually happened in southern Australia a few weeks ago. And you can imagine it can be worse if this happened to air traffic control or hospital and many more. The bad news is that as the distributed PV generation increase in the grid, this risk of imbalance increase. And that leads to the central theme of this work. If we do not think about greenhouse gas emission, we will many more people will say water invasion in either sea level rise or spontaneous flood. But if we put too many PV systems into the grid will be more insecure and it may cost someone their life. As a person who once has a flood invading my home and a person who has lost someone I love, both ends are difficult to live with. Hence, there should be a limit. We have two goals here. We want to identify the limit of distributed generation given the current condition of the grid. And we need to have a plan if we want to increase the limit by modifying infrastructure or policy. And just to spoil you what's going to happen here, if you want to pretend that you have written this thesis, just remember these two words. Variability and volatility, these two are going to be the factor that determines the limit. Variability of solar power is the fact that the typical average solar power varies with time and is not well aligned with the electric consumption. If both of them are well aligned, you don't need to have any extra generator to schedule. Another term is volatility of solar power, the fact that solar power can be different from what you expect. If the volatility is zero, you don't need to have any backups after you schedule the generators. Our work tried to distinguish between these two terms and formulate it so that we can identify which one is truly the bottleneck of the limit, either variability or volatility, generators or backups. And this is the roadmap of this talk. First, we're gonna model the power output from a group of PV systems in distributed fashion. Then we're gonna come up with a simple model to explain the electric consumption or load, using a similar technique from the first part. Then we're going to combine the two models from first two parts in order to find the answer for our two questions. What is the limit? And what is the what can be improved to get a higher limit? First, let's talk about the distributed PV generation. We want to come up with a model to tell how much power is generated by a group of PV systems. As I told you earlier, power output from PV system can be volatile. So it is good to have something permanent and concrete as a backbone of the model. Fortunately, the maximum power from a group of PV systems tend to be stable not change. That leads to the first contribution of this work. This green curve is called normalized maximum power curve. It is a curve telling the power output from a group of PV systems over time of a year, and that group is normalized to be one to have a 1 kilowatt install capacity. It describes the ideal situation where the PV system can generate as much as possible. I like this black curve. This normalized maximum power curve will be useful in building the concept of volatility to build the prediction models and so on. It would be ideal if we can find this curve for every day of for every day in a year. But how can we find that? Well, in order to come up with a normalized power curve for an individual PV system, we can go through physics of it. And there is a traditional model to do so. But you can see here that there are so many details and so many steps from the sky down to the tiny electronics. Some of the details are difficult to measure accurately, and some steps are tricky to model. For example, even though clouds block sunlight, it can reflect sunlight and increase the power of PV system. Another tricky example is partial shading. If a half of solar panel is covered by shadow, you may guess that the power is reduced by half. In fact, it can reduce more than that because of another effect. Now, when we want to find a power curve for a representative system of a group, you can do something like this. First, you compute the individual PV power curve for each system, sum and normalize, so that it represents one unit of installation, which we set to be 1 kilowatt. The drawback of this structural approach is that you need to keep track of information from all systems at all times. So we propose a new method called a reduced form approach. In this way, we just need information of the capacity of a PV system in an area. Then we keep track of just a power curve, actual power curve from a sample of PV system in an area. We sum and normalize to get the normalized power curve. Note that not all of normalized power curve here is truly maximum, but we're gonna find the way to find just a maximum power curve. After going through many actual power curve from our data from both California and New Jersey, we can see that there are like a special type of power curve. We call it well-behaved power curve. It is smooth, single peak, and well-shaped. I like these two that have like a zigzag lines here. These normalized, well-behaved normalized power curve are what we are looking for. Imagine that the normalized maximum power curve from day one to day 365 stack together forming a roof. These well-behaved power curve are going to be like a beams of the roof. Once we find those curves, we can extrapolate it out to get the whole set of power curves. And this is how we can automate our selection. First, after trial and error, we found that the well-behaved power curve is in a family of non-negative polynomials called splines. So we fit each power curve with these splines. If it fit poorly, we throw that away. And if it has more than one maximum, we throw it away as well. There are going to be some bad power curve, for example, the power curve that has very low power output. That's needed from our selection, so we need to have another step. And a next step here is to consider the daily energy from a power curve. A daily energy of a power curve is just the total power generated by a group of PV systems on that day. That's equivalent to the area under the curve of power curve that we've seen before. We can compare the daily energy with the neighboring days, and if the daily energy of that power curve is significantly lower than their peers, we throw them away. That leads to a set of well-behaved power curve that we're gonna fit. So once we get that set of curve, we can use the fitted version to extrapolate and get the whole set. And the result is quite beautiful. So this is an example of a power curve, and you can see that the zigzag curve here is an actual power curve. If we stack them from day 1 to day 365, you get this color map. The vertical, the horizontal axis is time of a day, and the day, and the vertical axis is day of a year. You can see that there is a noise here because of volatility, and the noise in New Jersey tend to be more there compared to the California. Then there is a smooth curve here that we construct. It's the normalized maximum power curve. And we can make sure that it's truly maximum by shifting a little bit. Once we stack them all together, we get this nice and smooth curve. Note that this process is easier in California than in New Jersey because there are more clear days in California than in New Jersey. This color map is going to be the backbone of our model that we're going to build on later. Now, the next contribution is of this work from the normalized maximum power curve is to define the normalized volatility properly. There are some previous definition of volatility earlier using the concept of delta P, which is the power difference between two consecutive times. These definitions are not quite good because it gives counterintuitive values to a certain type of power curve. For example, by the definition by Hoff and Perez, this definition gives a non-zero value of volatility to the curve that really cross to the maximum power curve. The definition by Goldstein et al. Give a non-zero value of volatility to the curve that has very low power output. Our definition come up with a new term, which is the power difference between actual power and the power if the performance of PV systems remain the same. This R is performance ratio. This is a ratio of actual power and the maximum power. For these two types of curve, you can see here that the performance ratio is constant. So by our definition, we can give this value to be zero as we want. So this definition gives sensible values to these cases. And we can apply it into like general power curve, any type of power curve. We will see that this volatility is going to be useful in a model, predictive model and policy making later. Now, the next thing that we can do with the normalized maximum power curve is to build the distributed PV power prediction. It's like a marathon planner. You need to know your information before you make a plan to schedule things. And there are two types of predictions. Day-ahead prediction and hour-ahead prediction. In the day-ahead prediction, we want to know the whole power curve, of a day, one day before the operation. For the hour-ahead prediction, we just want to know a part of a power curve about an hour before the operation. Now, how can we come up with a prediction for the day-ahead prediction? We want to know the whole curve, and we can find it by using expected PV power curve. Expected PV power curve is just a scale version of the normalized maximum power curve. And the scale is calculated from performance ratios averaged from historical data. Here you can see that the dotted line here shows the expected power curve. We can use this as a prediction value of the power in the ahead operation. Note that we don't need fancy calculation here because the horizon is too far. We can modify our prediction, refine it later in the hour ahead phase. Now, let's look at the hour ahead PV power prediction. It's just asking what is the power output in the next time step. And that next time step, it can be 1 hour or 2 hours or 15 minutes. This is just a machine learning problem. We want to use a training set, which is a historical data, to find the model to predict from predictors to get the power output. And there are many components that you can tweak to reduce the prediction error. But we want to focus on the one that relates to the maximum power curve. So, and it's gonna be related to the performance ratios. Now, in the traditional way, you may think that you can use like current power output to predict the next power output. But what if we use a performance ratio of a current instance? First, predict the next performance ratio, then convert it to power output. It turns out that this method is helpful. This table shows the average and the maximum error relative to the mean value of the test set. And the data here, 3 months of 2 years of data from a group of about 100 to 200 PV systems is used as a test set. The remaining data from 2 years used as a training set. You can see here that once we use the performance ratio, the average error decreased. And once we use more sophisticated methods and include more predictors, including the volatility of the most from the most recent hour, we found that the maximum error reduced as well. Note that the maximum error here is quite high, like about from 50% to 80%, and that reflects the fact that the PV power output can be a harm to the grid operation because that it can give a high surge or drop in power. Now, let's move on to the second part of this work, which is load modeling. We want to model the electrical power consumption or load in the grid over time. When you think about it, this task might be difficult because it emerges from human behavior and human is not predictable as nature, right? But it turns out that it's not the case. Human as a group tend to have some dependency and follow common schedules of our society. We tend to use more energy during the days more than the night, during weekdays more than weekends, and during in one season more than another. In addition, since the humans as an individual have some levels of independence, that create a smoothness of the curve. Like you don't go to lunch at the same time, something like that. So that's create a smoothness and it makes the accuracy of load prediction higher than solar PV. Now, we want to do some load prediction and similar story to the solar, we want to do it on both day ahead and hour ahead prediction. And we want to borrow the same technique that we used in the first part. We want to refer it to something. But now we don't have any maximum power curve in this case. What should we do then? It turns out that you can find something as a reference in the past. These two color maps show the load over a year from a grid in California and a grid in New Jersey. You can see, as I said, there's a pattern that makes these two areas different. For example, you can see that in California, you don't need to use a lot of power in winter, but you need to have a lot in New Jersey. Now, if you follow the dotted line here, the axis here is the same, so this one is time of the day, and this one is day of the year. If you trace along this dotted line, you get what's called the daily load curve. It describes the load over a day from the grid. And if you look closely, maybe you not can see here, it's quite well, but if you follow another line of daily load curve from a previous day and a daily load curve from a previous week, they have a similar profile even though the whole curve may be shift up by, say, 20%. We just want the profile that's similar so that we can make a reference. In the day ahead prediction, we want a whole curve, but note that since it is day ahead, you cannot use information from a previous day right away. So we just predict the power output. We just want to predict the load to be just the daily load curve from the previous week. When we come up with the hour ahead load prediction, now we have two choices. Either the daily load curve from a previous day and a daily load curve from the previous week to substitute this. Remember from the first part, we have this one as a maximum normalized power curve. But now we're just gonna use the historical daily load curve. Let's see how we can reduce the error. These tables again show the average and the maximum error relative to the mean value of the test set. And the test set here is from 3 months of 2 years of data, from the whole grid. The remaining data is used as a training set. And you can see here that once we use a reference curve, both average and maximum error reduce significantly. And it seems that the daily load curve from a previous week works better. The error here is smaller. But if you average the predicted value from both cases, it turns out that it reduced even more. And once we incorporate more predictors that we discussed earlier, time of the day and day of the year, we can reduce the error even more. Note that the error here is just less than 1% compared to the mean power, mean value of the test set. To put it into perspective, I summarized the error of prediction here. And you can see that in New Jersey, the error of power output is smaller than the error in New Jersey because the weather in California is somewhat more pleasant than New Jersey. And you can see that the error of from PV output is significantly higher than the load. And that highlights the fact that solar power is bad for grid operation. And in the next section, we're going to talk about a concept called net load, which is the traditional load subtracted by PV power output. And you can see that as the amount of PV systems increase in the grid, the net load is going to be more unpredictable. Okay, so now let's go to the last part of this work. We want to answer our two big questions. What is the limit of distributed PV generation given the current condition of the grid? And what is the policy or infrastructure modification that we can do? Note that now that we have a normalized maximum power curve to represent solar power, we can scale it up to represent the high volume of PV systems. Let's see how we can answer the first question, the limit. In order to find the limit of distributed PV generations, we come up with two methods. The first method is going to be very simple. It's going to involve just the shape or variability of solar power and the load. Another one, we're going to come up with a more sophisticated concept of risk of demand-supply imbalance. And it's going to involve the prediction systems that we reviewed earlier. Let's look at the first limit. It's kind of simple and cute. So basically, it's like just asking, how can I raise my buddy in this doghouse? And the answer is you can raise him until a part of his body touch the doghouse. And that's pretty much it. We can increase the normalized maximum power curve up to the point where the power curve from the PV touch the load curve. And equivalently, we can say that we can increase the PV system as long as the net load is not zero, is not negative at any time. And here is the result. It turns out that in California, we can increase the amount of distributed PV generation up to 21.6 gigawatt. It's equivalent to 51% of the maximum load of the year, which we call peak load. In New Jersey, that capacity is about 31% of the peak load. And if you look at this curve, this curve on top is the net load. And the curve, red curve here shows the net load after we reach the limit. And you can see that the shape here is very different from the normal load, which is the bad sign that the grid operators need to work hard to match this new variation. If we want to think in terms of energy instead of power, we can calculate the area under the curve from PV system and the load. And we found that the distributed PV generations produce 22% of energy demand. In New Jersey, it's only 13%. Now, we want to find another limit that is more realistic and is going to involve the grid operation. So I just want to give you a simplified version of how grid operation works. This is very similar to the marathon story that I told you, but now we have proper term to use. First, we need to come up with a day-ahead prediction, which is to predict the whole daily net load curve for the day. Then you need to match this by scheduling generators of supply to follow this daily net load curve. Note that the generators in this phase tend to be cheap to use, but it's not quite responsive. That is the rate of change in power or RAM rate of that set of generators tend to be small. This operation must be done 10 a.m. before the operation day. That's why it's called day ahead operation. Then on the operation day, you need to do the same thing, but in a smaller scale, time scale. Once you go to the level shorter than 15 minutes, there is no further scheduling. You just have a set of backups, or technically called ancillary service, to follow the difference between the actual demand and the scheduled supply. If the note that the ancillary service tend to be very responsive, so it have very fast RAM rate, but the power capacity is small because it's expensive to operate. Now, if the difference between actual demand and the scheduled supply cannot be coped with the capacity of ancillary service, we call that the state of imbalance in the grid. We want to model this, we want to simulate this to measure the risk of imbalance, which is the rate of imbalance instance, once we're wearing the amount of PV systems. So in order to do the simulation, we need to have some inputs to these operations. And the first input is just the scale of the power curve, which is the capacity that you put into the grid. And you need to have some specifications for generators and ancillary service in the grid operation. For the generators, we assume that it has unlimited capacity, but the RAM rate is limited. In the case of day-ahead generators, the generators cannot have a RAM rate higher than 5% of the maximum RAM rate of the transitional load of the year. For the hour-ahead process, the generators can have a slightly faster RAM rate, but the capacity is said to be unlimited as well. For the ancillary service, in this case, it works differently from the generators. So we assume that the RAM rate is unlimited, but the capacity is kept to be 5% of the peak load. Now, for the input, we can collect some information from the simulation. First, we want to count the numbers of instances where the RAM rate of predicted net load exceeds the RAM rate of the generators from both day-ahead and hour-ahead operations. We want to count the number of imbalances as well. Now, if we understand it, we can simulate this by first change the number of PV capacity, run this every 15 minutes for 3 months, and collect this data, and keep changing the PV capacity and find this information. Now, the key concept here is the imbalance, and the imbalance is the instance that when the actual net load and the scheduled power is so different that the ancillary service power cannot keep it up. So the limit here is going to involve the concept of the risk, which is the rate of imbalance instance, like how often it occurs. And in this case, we set the limit of PV penetration to be the instance where the risk is at threshold, which we set to be 0.05%. And here is the result from the simulation. The horizontal axis here is the amount of PV capacity in the grid. And the vertical axis here is the risk of demand supply imbalance. And as you may expect, as the amount of PV system increase, the risk also increase. And we can set the cap at 0.05%. And you can see that the max capacity here is 50% of the peak load in California, and is 9% in New Jersey. if you consider it in terms of energy, it turns out that both cases give only single digit percent of energy demand. So it's a bad news for PV guys. So what can we do to increase the limit of PV penetration? And it turns out that we can do it in two ways, either in terms of infrastructure or in terms of policy. For the infrastructure, we can upgrade the ancillary service. And for the policy, we're going to come up with a policy called PV curtailment. I will explain this later. But first, let's look at the infrastructure. When we say infrastructure, there are generators and ancillary service. But why we choose to upgrade ancillary service instead of the generators? The answer lies on this graph. The first two graphs here is the one that we've seen earlier. It is the risk of demand-supply imbalance. But these two curves below here shows the number of instances where the ramp rate of predicted net load exceeds the ramp rate of the generators. This curve is for day ahead, and this curve is for hour ahead. If you look closely here, right on the right-hand side of the limit, so when we go slightly beyond the limit, the number of instances where the ramp rate exceeds is still zero for a while. That means that we can increase the ancillary service to reach the new limit without worrying about generators. And in order to increase the ancillary service, we can do it in two ways, either generative or non-generative. Generative ancillary service is the ones that actively consumes or generate powers. An example would be a gas-fired power plant that very responsive. Another kind is non-generative ancillary service. It's the one that just store energy and use it later. An example is flywheels and electric storage. Note that the most common form of ancillary service is generative. So we assume that ancillary service in our simulation is all generative. So if we want to simulate the effect of adding generative ancillary service, we just go back to our model and modify the specification in our model. It turns out that we can increase the ancillary service by 3% of the peak load to reach the new limit without modifying generators. If you want to add non-generative ancillary service, or you can understand it as storage, it's more complicated because you need to have a control when to store and when to use energy. We come up with a simple heuristic of when to use energy based on the amount of energy left in the storage. And I don't want to go into the detail here, but I just want to show you that it is possible. It turns out that in the case of California, we can add the non-generative ancillary service of energy capacity of 0.4 hours times 5% of the peak load to reach the new limit. But we need to double that capacity for New Jersey. Now, let's move on to another way to do it without involving infrastructure at all. Now we're going to focus on the policy. And we can come up with PV curtailment. PV curtailment means that we are going to allow more PV systems into the grid, but we're going to disconnect some of them when the grid is at risk of imbalance. But how can we know that the grid is at risk of imbalance beforehand? We look into the volatility. It turns out that the prediction error of the models that we viewed before, the errors correlate with the volatility. So we can come up with a policy based on a function of volatility. If the volatility is low, we can put all PV systems into the grid. But if the volatility is high, we're going to disconnect some of them until the volatility is lower again. I just want to show you the example of how it can be implemented. Note that the number of instances that we allow to have under this 0.05% threshold is 5. So we need to keep the number in the circle to be less than 5. And you can see here that we can increase the amount of PV system up to 1 to 2% first and allow it into the grid. But once the volatility is high, we decrease the amount of PV system down like this. So you can see that from this number, this is the current limit that we can set. We can increase the amount of installed PV system by 1 or 2%. This is a summarized session of all summary of all limits that we talk about. These blue arrows show the first limit that we get by the simple concept about the doghouse that I talk about. And this second limit here comes from the fact that we set the threshold of the risk of demand supply imbalance to be under a number 0.05%. We can increase it by adding ancillary service up to these green arrows. And we can even get higher by 1 or 2% using the PV curtailment policy. If you want to go beyond and get to the first limit and other things, we need to have a major modification on generators in scheduling first. Now, let's see what's down the road towards further investigation. And there are like two opportunities we can explore here. First is about more elaborate consideration of space, as I talked earlier. In terms of space, I mean, we can do this kind of analysis at any node in the grid instead of the whole grid here. Once we have an analysis from each node, we can connect them using power flow analysis and network constraints to reach to get a more realistic implementation. Another interesting topic that we can look at is the cost benefit of adding distributed PV generation. Note that our analysis here is in favor for PV industry. We just try to put as many as PV systems in the grid without breaking the risk of demand supply imbalance. But it's not guaranteed that this is the optimal way to do for the society. Because once we add more PV system, we need to put more storage and implement policy. Once we know more about the cost of each component, like cost of storage, cost of adding sensors and things, we can find the optimal value of distributed PV generation, not just the possible value. And I hope now I can convince you that the distributed PV generation is a choice of clean and renewable energy, but it cannot be the only sole supplier. We have discussed how to formulate it and come up with a concept of variability and volatility and how they are closely connected to the grid operation in terms of generators and ancillary service. From the concept of maximum power curve, we come up with models and things to help grid operation better, and we can come up with the limit of distributed PV generation. We also suggest several ways to improve the limit as well. Now, the resource here, as you can see, is highly dependent on the areas. For California and New Jersey, you can see that it depends on the weather, depends on the nature of solar power there, and it also depends on the assets in the area, like generators, ancillary service, and even the load pattern of each area. And you can see that the problem is complicated, and to find a sustainable and reliable solution, we need more and more thoughts on it. And there are many efforts to do this in many areas, like in wind power, in load shedding, energy efficiency, and many more. And that's the beauty of it, like the diversity makes it worth solving. And as you see, like there are many branch and leaf putting power together, it makes the root of humanity strong, not just humanity, but I mean the whole biosphere. And I'm glad to be one of them who put like a single cell or atom there in this tree. And that's pretty much it. I would like to give some acknowledgement to people, and actually I can give more, way more than this, like an hour or so, but I can keep it short. Okay, first I would like to send special gratitude to my committee here, Professor Kim Jo Law, Yin Yu, Bob, John, and Walter. And let me brag about Walter a little bit because he's a fun guy to talk with. So at first I thought like Walter is like a Wikipedia in person, and his wife confirmed so. Yeah, and once I know more about him, I see that he's not only like a Wikipedia person, but he has wisdom and kindness that's exceptional. So exceptional that I feel like, how can I be a good advisor like him when I become a professor? So yeah, thank you so much. And I would like to thank all my teachers who teach me all sorts of things from simple to sophisticated and made me appreciate this work. I would like to thank my friends as well for coming. Because of your awesome friendship with my old friends, it made me spend less and less effort to make a new friend. But yet some of you, the friends that I just know here, you still care to be friends with me. So I really, yeah, thank you for that. And finally, I would like to give to say thank you to my family. My brother, he's now older. Yeah, and my mom and my dad. Yeah, they worked so hard to get me here. And yeah, if I pass this exam, it's not my success at all. It's all them, theirs.
Is a flood in there?
Huh?
Flood. Is that grass?
Flood.
Flood.
No. Okay, this one is.
Photoshop.
No, it's like a. One of the university.
You're gonna finish this thesis fast.
Yeah, I have a fun when I was in high school. Yeah, but okay, it seems like you already have some fun, but yeah, just I give you a picture of a cat.
Is it your cat?
No.
Why did you pick this?
You can't guess why I picked this cat.
Let's try to balance.
Right. He tried to balance under the sun.
Yeah. No.
So the third item is open questions to the public.
So in your concluding session, you said that you looked at California and New Jersey, and you see different outcomes for the local. So have you looked at more maps? And is there like, can you, I don't know, like basically find similar patterns in some?
Yeah. Okay. So. In terms of work that has been done before, there is attempts to come up with 5 geographical areas based on survey. So it's, in some sense, can be useful. But in order to get a fine analysis, we need information on solar output. As I told you earlier, it's not just about the weather, because it also depends on like how people make their house and like culture in that area. And because we have data just for like, California and New Jersey that has enough PV system that we can build up a consistent model. So that's why we can do from these two. But you can see that if we have more PV system in the like entire district, we can apply this model everywhere. You can see even in New Jersey that has very poor weather. If we collect enough data, we can select those clear days and come up with a meter.
So you said that you have to throw away. You said that sometimes like power curves are not well behaved, and you have to throw them out.
Mm-hmm.
So about like how many percent of the power curves are well behaved?
It depends on the area and. I think this one is from California. I can guess from this because you can see that there are many days that have very low power. So So from the first selection, the number is about 60%, I think, in California. But after the first selection, in the second selection, we just throw like very few amount. So I would say it's the same number. But in New Jersey, we throw basically most of them. They are only about like 20 days. But it's good because those 20 days are like scattered in a distributed way, not just like in a group. So we can still extrapolate from that.
Can you go to the slide that have prediction numbers? Load prediction
power.
And power.
The summary or the
This one.
Okay.
Yeah. So I wonder, do you have any baseline to say like we should, whether like 5% is high or like how do you interpret these numbers?
Okay. So there is researchers working on this kind of load predictions. And I would say the number for the average error, I mean, you can see that this analysis is for the whole grid, but there is different levels of prediction. You can prediction is for a substation, for the whole grid, and so on. For the whole grid, I think the typical value is about 1% mean. But I want to highlight another fact here is why we need to report this maximum error. We need to report this maximum error because we want to see the extreme condition where the grids go wrong. And there is like a, how would I put it? It's like a second nature of people to do things in mean square. But the mean square error is not useful here. So in the literature, you will see that there are many reports about the mean value and the mean square error. But it's not useful in this analysis because we want to come up with the one that tells when the grid is at risk.
Any more questions? Now you can ask them questions.
which slide do you like most?
they must understand everything you said. Right? Just like a regular teacher.
First time.
So, anyway, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let's take 15 minutes break.